Okay, so let's keep rolling. We're on to still in part three, being for others. Now, chapter three, the final chapter, concrete relations with others. So, in this chapter, Sartre is going to outline the various fundamental modes of being of the for itself, in which its original relations with the other is manifested. So, the original question that we started with way back at the beginning of this the book is, what are the relations of the for itself with the in itself? But now we now have now realized that this question is more complicated, since it's and ought to be rephrased, what is the relation of the for itself with the in itself in the presence of the other? So this recognition that there is another ontological structure being for others, which makes up our which makes up human existence, complicates things a little bit. So when the other objectifies me, as we've seen, I can't transcend or know this, but I can take an attitude on it. And these attitudes are what Sartre calls our concrete relations with others. So there are basically two options here. One is I can just make an object of the other. I can turn my look on him or her and make them an object for me. Or, since the other in his or her freedom can found my being in itself, then I can attempt to, as an object, recover and possess the other's freedom as a freedom, thereby becoming the foundation of my own freedom. Does that make sense? So I can make an object of the other with the look, that's clear enough. But I can also attempt to. So what's happening here is that the other is making an object of me. So when they're making an object of me, what I can then try and do is grab their freedom as they're making an object of me, grab their freedom, but not while not making them an object, while letting them preserve their nature as freedom, their subject status, which means I remain an object. So if I can somehow grab their control, or control, I think it's a good word, control their freedom while they are being free, so without subjugating that freedom in any way, controlling that freedom as a freedom, letting it remain a freedom, then I can come to know myself the way that the other knows me, as an object, as a thing. Which means I can. It's another way of trying to fulfill that ultimate goal of all consciousness, which is to be for itself, in itself, come to know oneself as a thing. And that's the other possibility. So we'll have a look at those in a minute. Just before we kick off, though, what we have to remember is everything that we're talking about in here, it's quite interesting, a little bit strange, but definitely interesting. What we have to remember, everything that we're talking about is needs to be envisaged within the perspective of conflict, because ultimately that's what Sartre thinks the fundamental nature of our being for others is. It's all conflict based, you know, the subject and object, and turning your look on the other to make them an object for your subject, and so on. So section one, is called the first attitude toward others, love language masochism. Okay, masochism, yeah. So that's where we're at. So this is the second option I talked about before. So this is the attempt to recover and possess the other's freedom. So for this to happen, two things need to be true. One, I assert the other through an internal negation that never changes. and two, the other remains subject and I remain object. So it's kind of like trying to turn your look on the other without turning them into an object at the same time, letting them remain subject. So the goal here then is to identify with the other's freedom as it founds my being as an object, which I think I've already explained. So this is impossible. Okay, this is impossible. In fact, I can never cross this boundary between me and the other to really come to found myself through him or her. So it's impossible. In fact, I can never cross that divide separating us. It's also impossible in theory, because if I was able to unify with the other, then I would cause the other to disappear, which means that founding of myself would also disappear, because it would just be me. It would just be this for itself merged with the other, so that there would no longer be an other through which I could found my freedom, found my being. And the other thing to note here is that the other transcends my transcendence, right? So to accomplish what I want to do, to found my own being through them, I would have to act on the other's freedom, their transcendence. And as we've seen, that's completely impossible. There's no way I can get to their status, their nature as consciousness. At the most I can grasp them is as an object. I can never get to them as a subject. Nothing about them refers me to them as for itself, to the other as for itself. So acting on the other's freedom is impossible. However, this is what Sartre says love is. It's that attempt to found your own being through the other while remaining an object and letting the other remain subject, which means that I, as object, have to act on the other's freedom as a subject. And that's what love is. A definition of love I bet you haven't heard before. So from a psychological perspective, Sartre just quickly defines love. It's an effort to capture a consciousness, to possess a freedom as freedom, which demands that this freedom, however, no longer be free. So there's that conflicting element again. So in order to achieve this, the lover can't be the cause of the others no longer being free. They have to remain free, but there's a demand as well that they no longer are free. But I can't cause this to come about, because if I do, then I'm limiting their freedom. And they have to remain completely free. Somehow I have to grasp them, grab them, their freedom, without impairing that freedom in any way. And if I'm the cause of this whole cycle, this whole process, then I'm impairing their freedom and I'm not grasping it as a freedom. So rather than being the cause of it, I want to be the privileged occasion of it as an object. If this could happen, then I would become what Sartre says unsurpassable in the other's consciousness. So I'd be saved from instrumentality. I've become an object transcendence. And I'm just going to keep going. An absolute center of reference around which all the instrumental things of the world are ordered and the source of all value. Ultimately, I would no longer be the top. Done. So again, just all of that stuff just refers to my ultimate goal of just founding my own being, no longer being this contingent, superfluous thing, being grounding myself in my own being. So what this means is that if this was possible, if I could grasp the other's freedom as a freedom and found my being through them, then I would become the object by whose agency the world will exist for the other. A quote from Sartre, which is worth repeating, I think: I must be the one whose function is to make trees and water exist, to make cities and fields and other men exist, in order to give them later to the other who arranges them into a world. So it's that idea that in catching their freedom, what I'm doing is placing myself between them and the world. So to get to the world, they have to go through me. And that means that I become indispensable to them. I'm still an object because I have to keep that keep my object status, but I'm an indispensable object, an unsurpassable object. They can no longer reduce me to the status of just an object. I am indispensable to them. And so, because the world is revealed through me, so I'm no longer just superfluous, de trop. I'm no longer just contingent. My being becomes necessary and grounded. And that's the goal. That's the goal here. So he, the lover, will be the world. Instead of just being a this, detaching itself on the ground of the world, I am the ground as object on which the world detaches itself. Cool. So how do we go about this? How is this project of love carried out? Seduction. So the goal here is to attempt to be a fascinating object for the other. So you remember, we've talked about fascinating before, and when an object is fascinating, the perceiver disappears. They become completely immersed in the object, and that becomes their consciousness is nothing other than that object. That's what it means to be perceive a fascinating object. So if I can become a fascinating object for the other, then the other is reduced to nothing before me, which satisfies our goal, accomplishes our goal. And what we also find is that as I present the world to the other, I'm the intermediary between the other and the world, I also show my infinite power over it. And I do this through things like money, cars, you know, power, all of these things that we typically associate with kind of attraction, or which are supposedly valuable. So this kind of explains that drive we have more money, to be more appealing to members of the opposite sex. So this all takes place through language, which is the second part of this section. All takes place through language, which is not just the spoken word, but it's all phenomena of expression. And Sartre says, in fact, language is being for others. being for others being the fact that a subjectivity experiences itself as an object for the other. So language is this fact, this being for others. And in using language, there are two dimensions to this that Sartre mentions. In using language, one, I don't know what effect my gestures and attitudes will have, because they'll be given meaning by a freedom which surpasses them, a freedom which I have no control over. And this makes language sacred, because it all points to a transcendence beyond my world, a transcendence that I can never grasp. And so language is sacred because of that, but it's also magical. The magical dimension comes from the other, viewing language from the other perspective, the other's perspective. So the other cannot get from my expressions to my transcendence. We can never get to the other's transcendence, right? So that inability to go from my expressions, from my language, to my transcendence means that language for the other is magical. It has no ultimate, added meaning or reference to anything special. It's just, remember anger, we talked about anger in the last video. Anger is the clenching of the fist and the stamping of the feet, or whatever reveals it. It doesn't refer to any transcendence behind it, because we can't get there. We just can't get to that transcendent, free being for itself. So that makes language magical. Now, I've already said that this whole project is doomed to failure. It's impossible. So love is ultimately futile. And another reason Sartre gives is just being fascinating is not enough to produce love. Love also requires that the other love the lover, love me. So I'm trying to achieve my goal here by loving the other, but the other also, in order for this goal to work, they must love me as well, which means they will try and get me to apprehend them as an object. So it's more conflict arises yet again. And Sartre gives he calls this thing the impossibility of love, the triple destructibility of love, in these three ways. First, lovers fail to overcome the factual nothingness which separates them. That's the first obstacle that we cannot overcome. Secondly, each consciousness can perceive the other as object at any time, and that destroys this whole endeavor. And finally, love can be dissolved by a third person. So when a third person comes on the scene and looks at us, this love that we have generated, probably I have generated between me and my beloved, is reduced to love as object in the eyes of the third person, and it's then alienated towards them, alienated from me, from the other, towards this third. And that, Sartre says, explains why lovers seek solitude, which is it's kind of interesting. It's kind of what I quite like about this is the way that Sartre ties this into common, real everyday experience. Lovers do seek solitude, and he's giving us a nice kind of, you might want to dispute its veracity, but it's a nice kind of neat explanation of this. That's why lovers seek solitude, because they want to avoid a third person constituting their love as love as an object. However, of course, it's impossible to avoid this third, because physical absence, you recall, is still that original presence. We still exist in a world full of others, even if they're not physically present at the time. So the failure of love, all of this talk about love failing, this leads to despair. And despair results in masochism. So what's masochism? It's the attempt to completely abandon my transcendence and be nothing more than being as object. So that's interesting. It's interesting. Again, like it's an interesting take on our relations with others, right? Even though instinctively you probably want to disagree with it. You know, love being this unlovely phenomenon, right? That he's talking about. It's this attempt to ground your own being through the other. And it's quite selfish in the end, right? That's the way Sartre is approaching this. So I think you can disagree, you can dispute what he says based on that. But on the other hand, he's right too. You know, if you think about our relations with others in this way, as this kind of conflict. The other looks at me and I try and look at them, and our fundamental goal of trying to be a for itself in itself. This makes sense, you know, this conceptual framework which is erected here makes sense. Which I think doesn't guarantee its truth, but it's one way of interpreting love. And I think it can't just be dismissed out of hand just because that's too negative or it's too depressing. I think it makes sense. It's coherent within Sartre's philosophy, and that's what's interesting. So anyway, back to masochism. The attempt to completely abandon my transcendence and be nothing more than an object. So in this and going this route, I'm attempting not to fascinate the other by means of my objectivity, but to cause myself to be fascinated by my objectivity for others. So it's just diving deeper, if you like, into this trying to be an object. It didn't work through love, so now I'm just okay, to hell with it. I'm just gonna do it for myself. I'm just an object. I just want to be an object. And that's interesting. And what Sartre says, another way to cash this out, Sartre says it's the assumption of guilt in two ways. First, guilt toward myself because I consent to my being as an object. So masochism is trying to be an object, that it makes me guilty because I'm denying my transcendence, just trying to be an object. That's guilt for me. But I'm also guilty toward the other because I'm giving them the chance to be guilty of ignoring my transcendence and treating me just as an object. So I'm guilty in two ways through this masochism. Of course, masochism also fails in its ultimate objective, because it's impossible to be an object for myself. I will always only be object for the other while remaining a transcendent freedom for myself. I can't escape that. Even though I might try and trick myself, deceive myself through bad faith, I can't escape that. I'm always, always a transcendent freedom. And that brings us to the second section, which is entitled Second Attitude Toward Others, Indifference, Desire, Hate, Sadism. Okay, so something you probably never thought about there, as far as your relations with others. But let's have a look what Sartre has to say. So the first step in this second section is indifference. So this is where we treat the other as nothing more than an object. And this is characterized, Sartre says, by a blindness that ignores or denies that the other can direct a look back at me and make me an object. So I want to treat the other as just an object. And this reassures me because it means I'm free from the other. I'm free from them. There's no longer any danger of me being suffering under their look and being reduced to an object. Of course, this is inadequate. Because the other is freedom and my objectivity are still there. They're always still there. They're given in my comprehension of the world, and they result in a perpetual feeling of lack and uneasiness. So we never fully escape this idea that the other can be something more than just an object. And it's also inadequate because, of course, it means I can never be my own foundation. It robs us of that opportunity to found our own being through the other. So this uneasiness, though, that we feel this uneasiness when we try and reduce the other merely to an object through indifference, this uneasiness can prompt a new effort to capture the other's free subjectivity through making him or her an objectivity for me via sexual desire. So, the first thing Sartre says here is sexuality is not a physiological affair. So, he wants to talk about it in an ontological sense, an existential sense. So he says it derives from our being in the world and our being for others. So we're looking at this whole process through the lens of existentialism. And he says, we apprehend the others and my own sexuality through desire. So that's where we're going to start from, this phenomenon of desire. So what is desire of? Well, Sartre says it's not pleasure, because we prefer one person over another, and if we were just after pleasure, then we wouldn't distinguish between different people in this way. And it's also not for sex, because through the act of sex, that desire is extinguished. So he says desire would never aim to destroy itself, and that's what it would do if our desire was for sex. Then essentially, the desire's aim is to eliminate itself, extinguish itself. So what is it desire of? It's desire of a transcendent object. Okay, it means a body, but not a body in isolation. As we saw in the last video, a body in situation. So what we have then is this case where desire posits the world and desires the body in terms of the world, and then it desires parts of the body in terms of that body. So we're always there's always a bigger picture. You know, someone might say sexual desires for a particular part of the body of the opposite sex. But that's not the whole story, because we desire that particular part on the ground of the body itself. But then we don't just desire that body either, we also desire that body in terms of a whole background, which is the world. So what we're after is a transcendent object. something, an organic totality with a consciousness. That's what we desire. So who does this desiring? Well, it's me, obviously, but not me as a pure flight from my facticity. Not me as a pure transcendence, the me as consciousness. Rather, it's me as an attempt to live my facticity. So what I'm doing when I'm desiring is subordinating myself to my own contingency, my own body. Not to transcend it like we normally do, not to surpass it, but to make myself body. So that's what I want. That's what I'm trying to do here when I'm desiring. So the next question then Sartre asks, why does consciousness make itself body? And what does consciousness expect from the desired object? Well, in desire, I make myself flesh in the presence of the other in order to appropriate the other's flesh. And this lets me grasp the body stripped of its situation. And Sartre calls this case to incarnate the other's body. So when their body is stripped from a situation, or incarnated, then it becomes just a pure body, a pure an object, flesh. And so that's why I make myself flesh. I make myself nothing more. I try not to transcend my body. I try to be my body completely in order to captivate the other, in order to incarnate the other, make them become their body in the same way that I am. So this incarnating, the way we go about this, it's by what Sartre calls the caress. And the caress, the goal of the caress is to cut the body off from its situation. So it's to render the body incarnate. It's to render the other incarnate in their body, which we do by separating it from, cutting it off from the situation, from any engagement with the world. So it just becomes flesh. So but still we haven't answered what the motivation or the meaning of desire is. Desire is primarily a relation with the other, and what it is when I try to ensnare the other's freedom through their body. So in making them incarnate, what I'm doing is trying to put their consciousness, their freedom into their body, and that will allow me to grab their consciousness through their physical form as an object. And I do this by making myself flesh, by incarnating myself in an attempt to fascinate the other. There's that word again, fascinate the other, and provoke in him or her a desire for my flesh, because this desire will be an incarnation similar to mine. And so Sartre says then, desire is an invitation to desire, an object desiring an object, which in turn desires it. So that's sexual desire. Of course, like all of these relations, it's doomed to fail. Because once the other is incarnated in their body, to apprehend them, I have to use my own body as an instrument. in order to affect the caress and engage with them, I have to use my body as an instrument, not just as an instrument in the world, as we saw, as an instrument which I am. And this means that it ceases to be flesh. It's no longer just, then I'm no longer incarnated. I am that, what we looked at in the last chapter, I am my body for itself. So I'm using my body as a point of view, as an instrument, but not just an instrument like other instruments, as an instrument through which I create the world, through which the world comes to be. So I'm using it, I'm transcending my body, I'm surpassing my body, and that means that I'm no longer flesh, I'm no longer incarnate. So that destroys this whole endeavor, brings it to nothing. And also because the other too ceases to be flesh as soon as I use his or her body to apprehend them. And the examples, for example, Sartre gives pulling them to me or holding them. They're no longer just incarnation. They become an instrument which I can use towards my own ends in the world. So they're no longer this incarnated consciousness. So sexual desire fails on both, for both of those reasons. And this failure leads to, of course, sadism. What else? So sadism, I'm not mocking this at all. I think it's fascinating stuff. It's really interesting. But kind of left field, right? Like you'd never think of this stuff on your own, kind of, right? So anyway, that leads to sadism, where the goal is to seize and to make use of the other, not only as the other as object, but as a pure incarnated transcendence. So it's real. That seems really exactly the same as what we were just talking about, sexual desire. But the difference here is that the emphasis is on an instrumental appropriation of the incarnated other. And it's usually affected through violence. So that's where sadism is different from sexual desire. And it attempts to realize this incarnation in the other as obscene and ungraceful. Those are two words that Sartre uses. And what he means here is, if I can define grace first, grace is a movement in situation. So it's some movement in a synthetic totality, in a whole, which makes sense, which makes, the idea here is that it makes the body appear not contingent. And that's the fundamental problem, right? That we are this contingent being. So grace is movement that makes the body appear not contingent, that makes it appear as if it's the foundation of itself in order to do something. So it's quite interesting. It's quite a nice definition of grace, I think. Movement that gives the body, that frees the body from this superfluous, contingent bane, which is our existence. So then ungraceful, to be ungraceful is when that movement becomes mechanical. So we're no longer moving in situation. We're no longer appearing as if we're the foundation of ourselves. It's a situation where the body adopts postures which strip it of its acts. So acts, it's in a position with no meaning, no value, no purpose. There's no, it's unjustified. It's like taking that contingency and highlighting it. That's what ungraceful means. That's what obscene. It's that, it's movement and it's positions, body posturing, which highlights and exacerbates that our contingency, our superfluous nature, the superfluous nature of our being. And in order to incarnate the other's consciousness, the sadist needs proof, and that's where the demand for verbal humiliation or submission comes from. I need proof that they are purely incarnated, and I need them to confirm that for me. But this, of course, fails as well. And Sartre gives two reasons. One, if the other needs to be flesh, well, the other needs to be flesh, but they also need to be an instrument for me to use, which defeats that whole, the whole point of the exercise. And second, this, at any rate, the sadist can never act on the freedom of the other. That's what that's what this whole, Sartre's whole book is about, really. We're unable to act on another's freedom. That's always beyond us. We can't even know it. All we have access to is this, the phenomenon of the other. We can reduce the other to an object, and it's not just an object in the world, it's a special object, but we can never, nothing that object does ever refers to anything concrete which we can grab a hold of, anything transcendent which is concrete for us to understand or try and apprehend. So you can never act on the freedom of the other. Why? Because even though they submit, they might do everything that you demand, but they always freely submit. That's the point. So even though it seems like you've forced them into something, you've controlled their free transcendence, you've incarnated it in their bodies, and you've totally dominated them, but Sartre says they were always free to have held out for a little bit longer, held out for another day or another hour or another minute or another second. The timing when they gave up, when they submitted completely, it was totally up to them, the timing of that. So you never fully act on that freedom. So that's sadism, and Sartre just takes a minor detour here and mentions that just the mere fact of our existence, simply existing, means that I can never transcend the other's freedom. There's always conflict. It's inevitable, just because I exist. Even when we try and deliberately try to not impair or impede the other's freedom, we always do. Just our existence represents a factual limit on their freedom. And you might, an example that Sartre gives is to show tolerance to another. Even when we show tolerance and respect the other, then we force them into a tolerant world and remove possibilities for them to show perseverance in the face of adversity, or to show courage and resist oppression. We remove those possibilities from them. So we circumscribe their freedom even by trying not to, even when we try not to. So we can't avoid this nature, this conflict, this conflicting nature that's at the heart of being for others. And he uses this to highlight our guilt again. He gives two examples which are similar to the ones we've looked at already. When the other's look reveals to me my alienation. When the other's look shows me this alienated me, which always flees me in the direction of the other, and yet which I am, which I must assume, I must be this me, which is outside me. That is, I'm guilty for this. I'm guilty because I am this thing, but I have no control over it. It always flees me. It's my being outside me. And Sartre calls this our fall from grace. Just to perhaps explain in a way where, or give a less superstitious grounding for some of these religious ideas that have come down to us through Christianity. So he calls that our fall from grace. And the other aspect of our guilt is when I look at the other and cause them to experience the exact same thing. Again, I'm guilty in that sense. And this whole story about just our existence alone curtails the freedom of others and breeds conflict. This is our original sin, Sartre says. And what's more, it can never be absolved because all attempts to do so immediately rob the other of their freedom. So that's interesting, I guess, to have tied that back in. I think the mistake is to think that this somehow justifies, you know, Christianity and its ideas. I don't think we can go that far. You know, I doubt that the authors of the Bible had this in mind when they were talking about fall from grace. I think that's a bit of a stretch, but it's interesting. Sartre's able to interpret his philosophy here in terms of Christianity and a religious framework. So the last relation that we have to mention here is hate, which can be dealt with quite quickly. Basically, this is a final resignation, ultimate resignation. It's realization of the futility of attempting to ground oneself in the other, which was what all of the previous things we've talked about, love, masochism, indifference, sexual desire, you know, sadism, all of those things were an attempt to ground ourselves in the other. And so once we realize that all of that's futile, we simply desire to live in a world without others. That's what hate is. It's the will to just be in a world free from all others. Which of course is a failure as well. Because first of all, you could never eliminate every other. And even if you could, you could never make it so that the other had never existed. So the other will always be, will always appear, is always present in the world, even if they're not physically there, physically present. They're always present in that hodological space. You can't avoid the other. So hate's no good either. Which brings us to section 3, being with, mit sein, and the we. So Sartre asks here in this final small section of the second chapter, what about this third chapter, I should say, what about the situation when we discover ourselves in community with others? Can we not apprehend each other as subjectivities? Can't we get a communal kind of feeling through this experience? So he says the short answer is no. And the slightly longer answer is that the others are never an explicit thesis. Explicitly, we always posit the common action or the goal. Recognition of other subjectivities in the same kind of situation as us, Sartre likens to the situation where we're watching a movie with others. I am consciousness of this movie, but at the same time, I'm non-thetically aware of these other people watching the movie with me. So that is, in that sense, there's no, it's not a thetic, it's not a explicit thesis, it's not a thetic awareness I have of being with others. It's like a non-thetic consciousness, and that Sartre thinks is enough to render this experience non-foundational. So he investigates two things, two different ways we can experience a being with a Mitsein. The first is the us object, and this happens where a third person comes in and apprehends me and the other by their look. So that means that I'm in solidarity with the other. We're both being subjected to this look, but an us object, a something like an us object, is never experienced by either of us. All that's experienced is this solidarity we have. It's never experienced and it's never known either. And it's never known because we can't reflect on it. In order to know something, we have to be able to reflect on it. We can't reflect on this because reflection collapses any us that could have formed or that had been there. Because in reflection, the for itself posits its selfness against others. So we can never know any kind of us object that might be there. He talks about the us of class consciousness as well in this section. As in, like the proletariat, I guess, is probably what he was thinking of, against the bourgeoisie or something like that. So anyway, you've got this class consciousness, and he investigates it a little bit, but he says that shared conditions, first of all, are never enough to form a class, to create this us object in a class consciousness. They always require the appearance of a third who cause this us to be born by their look. And that's interesting because that is something we've seen again and again through history, right? People define themselves as a group in opposition to an other. And that's happened again and again and again in all manner of different situations. Which is again interesting, right? Sartre is explaining things that have happened and that happened that, and that we can experience in everyday life. But still, of course, even though this us as a class can form, there's still no us object that we're ever explicitly aware of. So the second example of being with that Sartre looks at is the we subject. And he investigates this through manufactured goods, which are made for consumers, consumers who experience themselves as they or we. And he says, manufactured goods make me known to myself as they, but this transcendence refers me to the image of any transcendence whatsoever. So we're not getting a, I'm not getting a we subject here. I'm just getting any kind of subject, any transcendence, an ambiguous, not ambiguous, what's the word? An anonymous they is what I'm, how I'm experiencing myself through this, through manufactured goods. The example he gives is a subway map. So if you think about a subway map, it's made for me, but it's not made for me as me. It's made for me as they. It's made for anybody, anyone to use this. So the idea then that we are, that there is a we subject here is an illusion, because it dissolves any kind of real concrete transcendence into an amorphous, anonymous they. Two things are required, or two things, there are two things to say about this. The first is that the we subject is a psychological experience, so it's not an ontological one. There's no unification of for itself happening here. As we saw, in fact, it's a anonymous experience rather than any kind of unification of any for itself. And also it can't be primary because it requires others in the first place. And that's basically his summary of being with. Us object is always dependent on a third coming along, which means it's dependent on being for others. So it's not foundational anyway. And the we subject is the same. It's a psychological experience, and again, completely dependent on being for others, which means that neither of these are foundational in any way, and that's what Sartre's interested in here, foundational, concrete relations with others. So it's interesting, that's this chapter, all about conflict, as you will have no doubt picked up on. And that follows from the fact that this fundamental project of the other is, when it comes to our being with others, is kind of twofold. First, protecting myself from becoming an other in the look of the other, and also to use the other to totalize, here's a little bit of jargon, to totalize the detotalized totality which I am, which means to know myself as what I am, to become for itself in itself. And so both of these overriding goals and aims naturally mean that our being for others is always dominated by conflict. Our relations with others are always underpinned by fundamental conflict. And these, the relations that we've looked at here, the concrete relations we've looked at, are, Sartre thinks, original, and they form the skeleton all other examples of concrete relations fall under. And so that's why he's focused on these, because he thinks they are foundational. I can't say it any other way. That's the way it is. So that's this third chapter. Next video we'll move into the almost the final chapter, part four. And almost to the end, so hang in there.